Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Kezia Dugdale.
The First Minister was rightly congratulated for securing the fiscal framework deal that protected the long-term future of the Barnett formula for Scotland. Central to that deal was the principle of no detriment. That means the transfer of financial responsibilities to this Parliament should never leave Scotland worse off. Yesterday's GERS figures showed that Scotland's deficit would be twice the size of the United Kingdom's. So does the First Minister seriously still believe there would be no detriment to Scotland leaving the United Kingdom?
First Minister.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it, to recall that if we look back to the last year of the last Labour government, the United Kingdom's deficit was £153 billion. That amounted to 10.2% of the UK's GDP. Now, I maybe just missed Kezia Dugdale telling Chancellor Alistair Darling back then that the UK could no longer afford to be an independent country. The truth of the matter is, Presiding Officer, countries the world over have deficits. And let's remember this about Scotland's deficit. It wasn't created in an independent Scotland. It was created on Westminster's watch. And it's a rather strange argument, I think, for any self-respecting politician to argue that we should stick with the system that created the deficit instead of taking more powers into our own hands to do something about it. And lastly, Presiding Officer, isn't it so typical of Labour that we hear nothing about the strong Scottish economy, the underlying strength of the Scottish economy? So I will leave Labour to do what Labour loves best, which is knock Scotland. I'll go on with the job of building this country up.
Kezia Dugdale. Miss Dugdale. Miss Dugdale.
Presiding Officer, that was about as convincing as Brian Suter's tax return. And the First Minister is in complete denial. The day after her own figures devastated.
Order, Miss Dugdale.
This is just 24 hours after her own figures have devastated the case for independence. She wants to carry on as if nothing has happened. The economic case for independence has always been dubious, but even her own former adviser, Alec Bell, tells us today it is now dead. Now, the GERS figures don't just raise constitutional questions, Presiding Officer. They also give us an insight into the SNP government's spending priorities. Investing in education is fundamental to growing the economy. Yet the GERS figures showed that the SNP have cut education and training by 10% since they took office in 2007. So if education is her number one priority, why has our government cut the budget by 10%?
First Minister.
Well, before I come on to education, which I will do in just a second, isn't it worth noting that the Better Together Alliance came alive in that last question? It is the case, isn't it, that all we get from Labour is a miserable talking down of Scotland and Scotland's prospects. You know, let's not forget that in the years when Scotland's fiscal position is stronger than the UK's, Labour still criticise the case for independence, because the truth of the matter is this, Presiding Officer. Labour prefer Scotland to be run by the Tories rather than having Scotland run by this Parliament. And for as long as that remains the case, Kezia Dugdale's party will remain on political life support. And on education, what the GERS figures yesterday showed actually is an increase in Scottish education spending of 1.7% between 2013-14 and 2014-15. And as we have out outlined, our attainment fund over and above core education budgets, doubled by the Finance Secretary in the budget, is going to make sure that we do even more to tackle the issues of attainment in our schools. So as I said before, Presiding Officer, I'll leave Labour to whinge from the sidelines, knocking Scotland. I'll get on with building this country up.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms Dugdale.
President, officer, she can't escape the facts. These are her own figures. She's cut education and training by 10%. But look, I can throw a number at the First Minister and she can throw another number back from that big book of excuses that she's got in front of her. But behind all of these numbers are people. People whose lives are currently being turned upside down because of SNP cuts to schools and other vital public services. Just this week, I spoke with three women who have been directly affected by SNP cuts. One uprooted her whole life to pursue a career in education, only now to be told that she will soon be out of a job. I met a school librarian just yesterday who was on the verge of tears and begged for my help to help her save her job. And a classroom assistant in Clackmannanshire, the very place the First Minister told me job cuts were exaggerated, told me that she was at a loss to understand the denial of our First Minister in relation to the extent of job losses. She says the figures on education cuts are wrong. So are these three women all wrong as well?
First Minister.
Let me just point out
First Minister.
Some facts to Kezia Dugdale. Average spend per primary pupil has increased by 9%, £411 since the SNP took office. Average spend per secondary school pupil has increased by 11%, £670 since the SNP took office. Average spending per pupil in Scotland in both primary and secondary schools is higher than it is in England. That is the record of the SNP government, but that is a record, Presiding Officer, that we are determined to build on. That's why we have prioritised education, tackling attainment in education. It's why the Finance Secretary doubled the funding for attainment in the budget just 2 weeks ago. And when I speak to people across Scotland, as I do day in and day out, what they ask me is this: if Labour is sincere about its commitment to education, then why, just 2 weeks ago, did they vote against a budget that maintained teacher numbers and doubled the fund for attainment in our schools? That's the question people across Scotland want to know the answer to.
Kezia Dugdale.
President, also, we voted against a budget that ripped £500 million out of our schools and vital public services. The reality is we couldn't believe her figures in 2014 and we can't believe her figures today. Why? Because we can see people losing their jobs. And the staff that remain face even greater pressure. And it's our young people who will lose out because of this government's cuts to education. For years, the First Minister said independence was the only way to stop the cuts. But that argument is now dead. Labour have set out a plan to use the powers of this Parliament to stop the cuts. But on the 50p tax, on the higher rate threshold and on the 1p plan, she has voted it down at each and every turn. So if Gers has confirmed that independence isn't the answer and she refuses to use the powers of this place to end austerity, what exactly will she do to stop the cuts?
First Minister.
Well, actually, if we think back...
First Minister.
If we think back to the referendum...
Let's hear the First Minister.
It was Kezia Dugdale and her colleagues that said to people across Scotland that they had to vote no to avoid cuts. Now they go around Scotland telling ordinary people that their taxes have to go up to pay for the Tory cuts that Labour made us stay subject to. That, Presiding Officer... is the Presiding Officer, is the sheer and utter disgrace of the Scottish Labour Party. And to add to that disgrace is the fact that 2 weeks ago they voted in this Parliament against a budget that maintained teacher numbers, a budget that doubled funding for attainment in schools, a budget that would deliver the living wage to social care workers across our country. You know, Presiding Officer, there was apparently a Vote Labour event in this city of Edinburgh last night. Kezia Dugdale should read the reports of it. Apparently her name wasn't mentioned once in 3 hours, but speaker after speaker lined up to praise the SNP. You know, if Kezia Dugdale can't even enthuse her own side of the argument, is it any wonder she's already resigned herself to coming second in the election in May?
Question number two, Ruth Davidson. Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when she will next meet the Prime Minister.
First Minister.
I have no immediate plans.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you. The SNP's line on GERS and oil seems to be that everyone got it wrong and no one saw it coming. But, Presiding Officer, that's total rubbish. Because almost 2 years ago to the day, standing here, I told the First Minister's predecessor that he was being wildly optimistic on future oil revenues. We knew then that the OBR had put oil revenues for this coming year at £3 billion. But the SNP refused to listen, and they tried to con people in the referendum campaign by claiming it would be up to £8 billion. And standing there, the then First Minister told me, with some level of indignation, that his figures were robust. Well, not surprisingly, nobody trusts her predecessor on this anymore. But it wasn't just him. It was this First Minister who led that independence campaign. So why should people trust her on this either?
First Minister.
Well, she should maybe have tried giving some of that wisdom to the UK Government's Department of Energy and Climate Change, because their projection about oil prices was higher than the Scottish Government's. But isn't it typical that we have a Tory government that, just like their pals in the Labour Party, constantly want to talk down the prospects of this country? Let me tell you what the figures published yesterday show. And firstly, let me say this. £3,000 more revenue generated per head in Scotland in the last 5 years in the UK. Growth in onshore revenues outstripping the fall in oil revenues, higher employment in Scotland and the UK, faster productivity growth in Scotland and the rest of the UK. But we won't hear any of that from the Better Together Tory Labour Alliance, because that might mean talking Scotland up, and that would never, ever do.
Ruth Davidson. Ruth Davidson.
The truth is a £15 billion black hole from a leader that told us we'd all be £500 better off if we'd voted for independence. But you know, Presiding Officer, I think it's a great pity. I think it's a great pity that this First Minister is still tied to the salmon playbook of bluster and baseless assertion. Because the truth is that the SNP's economic prospectus for independence is broken. It was broken when they made it, they knew it then, and they know it now. And the SNP's discredited white paper will live on as a black spot on this First Minister's reputation. Absolutely. I'd like to quote again from the SNP's former chief advisor, Alex Bell, because he wrote that we must assume that these bright people here,
order, let us hear
with
Ms.
their
Davidson.
Bluster, know that the old model, once optimistic, is now dead. He is right, isn't he, First Minister?
First Minister.
Let me also quote from somebody during the referendum campaign, and this one's actually more relevant because, you know, much to my regret, Scotland didn't vote yes. Scotland voted no. And in that campaign, this is what the Prime Minister, David Cameron, had to say. There will be a £200 billion oil boom if Scotland votes yes. No. Why did David Cameron say that, and why did he turn out to be wrong? We'll take no bluff and bluster for the Conservative Party. The fact of the matter is, Ruth Davidson is the leader of a party that has stripped billions of pounds out of Scotland's budget. The parties that told Scotland they had to vote no in order to avoid cuts are the same parties now imposing cuts. And given that Westminster has created the Scottish deficit, why on earth would we stay part of that system instead of taking power into our own hands to do something about it?
Gordon MacDonald. Gordon MacDonald.
Mr Kusar Uddin, who is a resident of the Broomhouse area of my constituency, was on pilgrimage to Mecca last month with his wife and three children. During the final prayer of the day, there was a surge in the crowd and Mr Uddin tripped and grabbed hold of the nearest person for balance. Unfortunately, that person turned out to be a police officer and he was arrested for assault. Mr Uddin was sentenced to 35 days in prison, and there is concern that he may be subject to another trial that could result in a far longer sentence. Given that people who are in holy pilgrimage with their family do not travel with the intention to assault anyone, I ask if there is any way that the First Minister can intervene to assist my constituent.
First Minister.
Well, I am very concerned to hear about Mr Uddin's situation. Very large numbers of my own constituents go on pilgrimage to Mecca every single year, so I understand the concerns that have been raised by this case. My officials have already been in contact with the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, and they have advised that the British Embassy are now in touch with Mr Uddin by phone, and they have requested a prison visit via the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They've also advised us that at this stage they have not had Mr Uddin's sentence confirmed, as the case appears to be still under investigation. We have asked to be kept updated and informed of any progress, and I undertake today to provide the member with further updates as appropriate.
Question number three, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to the people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
Let's examine the consequences of our massive economic misjudgment on the finances of an independent Scotland.
Order. Let's hear Mr Rennie.
She says it's only 1 year's figures, but we all know the worst is yet to come. The £15 billion shortfall is twice the education budget, three times the European deficit limit, and she'd need growth figures five times higher than China to get out of this hole. She was warned repeatedly about her claims. Can she look me in the eye today and say she really believed what she said then? Or is it worse? Is it worse? Is our economic judgment really that bad?
First Minister.
Massive economic misjudgment. I think that is a very, very apt description of a party that goes into coalition with the Tories and keeps David Cameron and George Osborne in government for five long years. Let's never forget that party was the Liberal Democrats. And interestingly, right now, or until now, Willie Rennie is not looking me in the eye when I remind him of his coalition with the Tories. In a week after week, Willie Rennie's hypocrisy gets ever more breathtaking. Because while Willie Rennie's party was propping up George Osborne and David Cameron in government, those politicians were ripping billions of pounds out of the Scottish budget. So I will take no lectures from a Liberal Democrat on the question of cuts. And I bet the Scottish people cannot wait to yet again pass judgment on the Liberal Democrats on May the 5th.
I noticed that our Deputy First Minister leaned over to give her a bit of advice on that last answer, that same tired old answer. It's a shame that she didn't listen to the Finance Secretary before, because we all remember the secret dossier. The secret dossier happened to be right. He was right all along. Why didn't she listen to him back then? Now she spends all her time dismissing all the things that John Swinney warned about. The drop in oil revenues. She claims that £15 billion financial hole, it doesn't really matter. She supports independence no matter what the price. No fact or number will ever change her mind. But £15 billion, £15 billion is twice the education budget. Isn't it the case that the First Minister was ready to put independence before the education of our children.
First Minister.
Well, of course, we didn't need a secret dossier to see the implications of the Liberal Democrats' misjudgment, because we saw that unfold in George Osborne's budget every year for the 5 years Willie Rennie's party kept them in government. Billions of pounds taken out of this government's budget by Tories kept in office by the Liberal Democrats. And Willie Rennie has the nerve to stand here and talk to anybody about education and health and cuts in anybody's budgets. The fact of the matter is, we're living with the implications of Willie Rennie's party's decisions in government, and that's why I suspect his already very small and rather pathetic band of MSPs will be even smaller after May the 5th.
Question number four, Christine Grahame.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government considers that the rehousing provisions for victims of domestic abuse are satisfactory.
Tackling domestic abuse is a priority for me and for this Government, and we are investing record levels of funding. This year alone, we are committed to spending over £17 million to tackle violence against women and girls. Current homelessness legislation supports women and children fleeing abuse to be supported into temporary accommodation and enables appropriate settled accommodation to be found. Under long-established laws, women can also apply for an exclusion order from a court that suspends the right of the abuser to live in the family home. However, as I said when I spoke at Scottish Women's Aid conference on Tuesday of this week, more does need to be done in this area, and that's why the Minister for Housing and Welfare has offered to meet with Scottish Women's Aid to discuss what further support is required.
Christine Grahame.
Well, I thank the First Minister for that response and for the meeting, and I do recognise that not only the legislation but the funding from the Government to address abusive behaviour and its aftermath. But the First Minister will be aware of recent findings by the Women's Health Improvement Research Project in Fife, where the majority of women taking part felt they were given no choice about losing their home when ending an abusive relationship. So I'd ask specifically what the Scottish Government's response is to Scottish Women's Aid's call for a national strategy to address this issue, because surely it's abundantly clear that women should not be twice abused and victims.
First Minister.
No, I absolutely agree with that, and I am hugely sympathetic to the call made by Scottish Women's Aid for a national strategy, and that's one of the things that the Housing Minister will discuss in the meeting that I referred to. We do have very strong homelessness legislation in place. It has been described as some of the most progressive in the world. All homeless people have the right to temporary accommodation immediately, and if unintentionally homeless, the right to settled accommodation. And that does provide women with protection when they have to leave their home due to domestic abuse. But I do understand and hugely sympathise with the notion that forcing an abused woman to leave their home instead of staying in their family home compounds that sense of injustice and abuse. I think this is a hugely important issue, and one that with our partners and with other stakeholders in Scottish Women's Aid and other organisations, we are absolutely determined to do more to tackle.
Alison McInnes.
Very much. The Government has recently consulted on the introduction of a specific offence of domestic abuse. Does the First Minister agree with me that it should include provision for protection for women by placing conditions on perpetrators, including removing offenders from households, which would be similar, for example, to domestic violence protection orders in England?
First Minister.
Well, I'm happy to consider that. I mean, as the Member knows, we are in the latter stages of the consultation, and obviously what we're looking at is the specific wording of a new offence. Without ruling out what she's just said, what I think she might just have said maybe more to do with the disposals in court rather than the specific wording of the offence, but I'm very happy to look at it. Of course, the key purpose of this consultation and the proposed specific offence is to deal with examples of abuse, coercive and controlling behaviour that the current law doesn't deal with adequately, and that's the motivation behind this consultation. But these are important issues in terms of what happens to a woman who's trying to escape abuse, and I'll certainly give serious consideration to the point that's been made.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Exclusion orders are helpful, but often the abuser doesn't take any notice of them and breaches them. So therefore, safe housing is what is crucially required. What work has been carried out into creating refuge rooms and panic buttons in a victim's own home to make sure that they can get the help they need if the abuser breaches an exclusion order?
First Minister.
Well, there's a whole range of work often carried out by organisations like Scottish Women's Aid on that kind of issue. I'm more than happy to provide more detailed information about exactly what the Scottish Government funding, range of funding supports in that respect. But in terms of the key issue here, I am absolutely in agreement. There will be circumstances, of course, where a woman who has been the victim of abuse will want to leave and to move away and to start afresh without the influence of their abuser. But wherever possible, it's the abuser whose life should be turned upside down by the abuse, not the victim of that abuse. And that's what we should be working towards in every possible circumstance. This issue, not just the specific issue that we're talking about today, but the general issue of tackling violence against women and children, is one of the most important that this Parliament and this society can deal with. We celebrated earlier this week International Women's Day, and all of us did our own things to mark that. But we must recognise that domestic abuse, violence against women, is both a cause and a symptom of gender inequality. And until we tackle that, and until we eradicate violence against women, we will not have true gender equality in this country.
Question number five, David Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the RMT-commissioned report on the future of Scottish ferry services.
First Minister.
Well, we're committed to providing the best possible ferry services, and the announcements of a total freeze in fares for the Clyde and Hebrides services for 2016-17 and the £100 million order of two new vessels for the network underline that commitment. We remain focused on ensuring a fair procurement process that leads to getting the best deal for all of the communities of the Clyde and Hebrides. And it's important to say that no matter the outcome of that process, Scottish ministers will retain control of all important issues like fares and timetables, because this will always be a public service contract. Vessels and port infrastructure will also remain publicly owned as they are now. The law requires us to undertake a tender process, a position that we inherited from the previous Labour Liberal Democrat administration. This was accepted by that administration when it, of course, initiated the first tendering exercise for Clyde and Hebrides ferry services.
David Stewart.
Is the First Minister aware that the UK government banned Serco from tendering following an electronic tagging contract where they were claiming payments for prisoners who'd already died? Even at this 11th hour, would the First Minister agree to meet the author of the report, Jeanette Finlay, a respected economist from Glasgow University? And finally, would the First Minister share my view that Calmac are part of the DNA of the West Coast and Islands? And if they lose the contract in May, there will be no one to fly the banner for public ferry services in the future.
First Minister.
Well, I want to make sure that we have the best ferry services. I'm not, for reasons that I hope every member across this chamber will understand, I'm not going to comment directly on the tender process that is underway. I will say, though, and I'll be corrected if I'm wrong on this, but I am pretty sure that the ban on Serco that the member referred to has since been lifted by the UK government. But we are required under EU law to put this service out to tendering. There was a motion passed in this chamber in September 2005 before the first tendering exercise that acknowledges that the tendering of the Clyde and Hebrides Lifeline ferry services is required to protect these vital services. That was a motion supported by Jackie Bailey, by Sarah Boyack, by Malcolm Chisholm, Patricia Ferguson, Hugh Henry, Joanne Lamont, Lewis MacDonald, Ken McIntosh, Michael McMahon, Duncan McNeill, Elaine Murray. So that was the position of the last Labour administration. It is the position of this administration, but it is all intended to make sure we get the very best services for the people who rely on what are, after all, lifeline services.
Question number six, Roderick Campbell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to figures from the Association of Leading Visitor Attractions, which show a 5.5% increase in visitor numbers at attractions in Scotland in 2015.
First Minister.
Well, I'm delighted at the latest figures from the Association of Leading Visitor Attractions. They show that Edinburgh Castle is the most visited attraction in Scotland and that the National Museum of Scotland is the most visited free attraction in Scotland. The latest official statistics show that if we combine overseas and domestic visitors, there's been a 7% increase in total tourism visits to Scotland in the year to September 2015, and combined visitor spend increased by 18.8% between 2010 and 2014. I think this is testament to the hard work and the skills of everyone in our tourism and hospitality industry in Scotland, and also to our public bodies who are working in partnership to support the Scottish Tourism Alliance and industry-led tourism strategy 2020.
Lord Campbell.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. I'm pleased to note that one of the leading attractions was Falkland Palace in my own constituency. But I'm sure the First Minister will agree it's important to consider how tourism can grow. One such way is to improve accessibility. We have in Fife an Accessible Fife project. What support can the Scottish Government provide for initiatives such as this going forward to improve disabled access to Scottish visitor attractions and to increase the numbers of tourists generally?
First Minister.
Well, I'm absolutely in agreement that we need to support and to grow accessible tourism, not just because it helps us tap into a market that is potentially worth £1.5 billion to our economy, but also because it's absolutely the right thing to do. The Scottish Government has provided Visit Scotland with a funding contribution to develop a guide to help boost the wider accessibility of events. At the industry launch of the 2016 Year of Innovation, Architecture and Design, the Minister for Business announced additional funding to support a series of new partner projects. So each of these initiatives will contribute to that wider accessible tourism drive, and I think it will be very important that that happens, both in terms of the inclusivity of what Scotland has to offer as well as the economic benefit it will bring.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. We are now moved to members' business, so members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.